from the story in the Bible, the truth that's in the Bible about Jesus. And I'll read out of Mark chapter 15. And Jesus was sinless, and he had done no wrong. But the people cried out in verse 13 of Mark 15. And they cried out again and said, "Crucify him." Then Pilate said unto them, "Why? What evil hath he done?" And they cried out the more exceedingly, "Crucify him." And so Pilate, willing to content the people, released Barabbas unto them and delivered Jesus when he had scourged him to be crucified. And the soldiers led him away into the hall called Praetorium, and they called together the whole band. And they clothed him with purple and plaited a crown of thorns and put it about his head and began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they smote him on the head with a reed and did spit upon him, and bowing their knees, worshipped him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple from him and put his own clothes on him and led him out to crucify him. And that's what this song is about. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Tony.
Glory.
suffered and died that day for our sins, for the sins of the whole world, but that we might have life, and that we might have it more abundantly, and to give us hope. And because he lives, we can have life, and we can live today. We can have life abundant and full of joy today.
Amen.
And eternal, the hope of eternal life in a world where there won't be any sin. Huh? We look for that day. But in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I thought I would read about the hope that we have in Christ. Chapter 15, starting in verse 17, and it says, and well, the people were in that time were saying, was Jesus really rose from the dead? Maybe that didn't happen. But he had to raise from the dead according to the scriptures. And so Paul said, and if Christ be not raised from the dead, your faith is in vain, and you are yet in your sins. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. So if Christ hasn't raised from the dead, we don't have, our faith is in vain, we don't have any hope, and even the ones that are have died in the Lord, they're just dead. But that's not the truth. and Paul said, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. So, but we do have hope. And in verse 20 he says, but now is Christ risen from the dead, amen, and become the firstfruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, and that would be by Adam, by man, Jesus, came also the resurrection of the dead. For as Adam, in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we have life in Christ.
Amen.
And then, fuzzy lips.
They call him Jesus. He came to love. Buried in a tomb, but you walk out of here in freedom.
Amen.
That's God's heart today. He does not want you to walk out of here still carrying the same burden you had when you came in. That's not God. If you look out through the Gospels, you'll find that almost every town Jesus went in, he healed people. There were a couple places where the Bible says, and he could do no miracles because of their unbelief. For that, the only thing that's holding you back today from walking out of here in freedom is your unbelief. We have to understand that it's the truth that makes us free. And who is the truth? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I want us to walk out of here in freedom. We get bound up by so much junk. Come on, friends. We get bound up by life that holds us back from becoming who God said we were supposed to be. We were learning in Sunday school this morning something I knew, but probably a lot didn't know. But Pastor was talking about Barnabas. Paul and Barnabas. See, we understand God changed Abram's name to Abraham. He changed Saul's name to Paul. But did you know that Barnabas was not his original birth name? He was given a name by his parents that then exalted one. Woo! But when Paul saw his ministry, the ministry of who would become Barnabas, he changed his name to Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. See, you may have come under here under one name, under one banner, under whatever. You know, if someone would look at you today, what name would they put on you? Would it be grumpy? Would it be, you know? Or would it be child of God? Encourager. Lifter. Someone that always, when you're around them, they lift you up. Some people were just perpetually born to smile. Sometimes Michelle's one of those. And Jenny, actually, does it come from your family? All three? I don't know. But anyway, sometimes it gets on my nerves. Please. Sometimes you just don't want to deal with happy people. Come on. Especially early in the morning. Karen told me I couldn't squint at her this morning because I always give her the squinting eyes. She told me I couldn't squint at her because she said if she did it back, she'd probably fall asleep. Yeah, I get it, okay? You know. But my purpose today is that you leave this place not how you walked in. There's an old song we used to sing when I was growing up, you won't leave here like you came in Jesus' name. Bound, depressed, tormented, sinnerly. For the Spirit of God is still the same. You won't leave here like you came in Jesus' name. I believe the Holy Spirit can do a work in our midst today, in your life. And you can walk out of here not the same person that you were that you came in with. Punch your neighbor. Tell them, I'm leaving different. No, I'm leaving different. Do you mean it? I mean it. I want you to leave here different than how you came this morning. You have your Bibles. Let's go to the book of Matthew. Let's start reading in Matthew chapter 27, starting in verse 45. I'm going to read a little bit more today than I normally do. Sometimes I do it to one verse. And then a couple weeks ago, I think I read 10 or 11 or 12. And today, we're going to hear the truth from the mouth of Scripture. Heaven and earth passes away, but His Word remains. And if we can stand, Matthew chapter 27, starting in verse 45. Glory to Jesus. Say amen when you're ready.
Amen.
It says, now from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness all over the land. Sounds like a good movie start, doesn't it? And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Some of those who stood there when they heard that saying said, this man is calling for Elijah. And immediately one of them ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, and put it on a reed and offered it to him to drink. The rest said, let him alone. Let's see if Elijah will come to save him. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then, behold, the veil of the temple was torn into from top to bottom, and the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Let's pray. Father, I just thank you this morning that we can set aside this day, but Father, I thank you that we can celebrate every day the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I thank you that today he is not in a tomb. You can go where he was, and it's still empty. But the place to find our Savior is now sitting at the right hand, at your right hand, making intercession for us. So, Father, today I just rely on the intercession of Jesus Christ and the working of Holy Spirit in our midst today, that we would leave here changed, a changed people. We would leave here a resurrected people. We would leave here people who have freedom. Because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So help us. Change us. Help us to see the truth, know the truth, and let the truth set us free. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated. Bless the Lord, O my soul. I think about this day and how many people are in church today. And I was praying this past week about this message and this service. And how many people will attend church today that maybe hadn't for a while. I'm not putting anybody, I'm just saying. They will leave their church service today and they will walk out still miserable, still in pain, still under guilt, still under so many bondages that they didn't have to have. How many people today will hear a message on the resurrection of Jesus Christ and still stay in their tomb? It grieves and burdens my heart, because my heart, especially for this congregation, is that we don't walk or we don't stay in that tomb. We don't leave here still under the same bondages that we walked in with. And when I see people, I'm just talking about this group, but it's true church-wide. When I see people that leave here, and they're still struggling with the same thing. They're still dealing with the same problems, issues. They're still under such a weight that it bogs them down and they can't be who God has called them to be. It grieves my heart. Over the last 8 months or so, my prayer life has made such a turn. So many times in prayer, well, even without prayer, you know, how many know that God speaks in dreams and visions? Mm-hmm. I used to have a lot of visions, and I told God, stop giving me dreams. I don't want them anymore. That's all. Please don't do that. But I would have, literally, nightly, I would have these dreams. And I just got up tired. Tell somebody else. I'm being honest, being clear. But over the last while, I've been having dreams. And when I wake up, I don't remember the dream. I just remember a person. and I wake up praying for that person. I couldn't tell you what all the dream was about, but I can tell you who it was about. Many of you, I'd say probably all of you, he has given me a dream or a vision in the night, or spoken to me a word during my prayer time. Because how many of you know that you're not perfect? So, we all need prayer, don't we? We all need prayer. And so many times during my prayer time, or a dream or a vision, God has put you on my heart for a specific reason. And that reason was basically so that you would be free from whatever it is that Satan is trying to hold you down with. Whether it be a sickness or whatever it could be. Because, hello, we have sickness, but aren't you thankful that this sickness is only temporary?
Yes.
But there's a sickness, what I call a sickness that is unto death, spiritual death, is the sickness of having the disease of sin in our life that can only be cured by the blood of Jesus. So we all need prayer. So many times I pray that God would free us and change us and do a work in us. Not so that we can just be happier people. I like to be happy. But hello, my temporary happiness it pales in comparison to the joy that my God gives me. I can guarantee you in one day, some of you probably go from happy to sad 10 times. A lot of times, I'm happy, something good happens, and sure enough, an hour later, the floor falls out, and you're sad. It happens. It's life. We're all on a journey. We all get stuck into something. But I found something that it can only come from God. Psalm says it's joy unspeakable and full of glory. So my purpose, the purpose of the word today, is to free you out of that problem. Look at the scripture that we just read. Jesus, in verse 46, about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Have any of you ever asked that question yourself? Maybe you're going through a long-term battle or whatever. And maybe I've said this, so don't lie to me. Because I've said it. God, where are you? God, why am I going through this? God, why is this so difficult? Why is this hanging on so long? My God, why have you forsaken me? Because sometimes it feels like God left the picture. Sometimes it feels like God has just said, yeah, let them deal with it on their own. But I'm assured through the Word, when I start to think that way, I have to go back to the Word. And I know the Word says that when Jesus was born, one of his names was Emmanuel, God with us. I have to go back to the Word where he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. You see, my feelings may make me feel like I'm one thing, but the Word tells me the fact that God never left the situation. I just maybe stopped listening to you. Or maybe it's for my greater good. Sometimes we go through things, and it ain't the devil. Sometimes we go through things because it's God's plan to teach us and cause us to grow. How do I know that? If that was the case, if it was all the devil's fault, then Jesus, when he went to the cross, it wasn't because it was the devil's fault. Jesus went to the cross because God had a greater plan in mind. He wanted you saved. He wanted you to be one of his children. He said, they don't take my life. I give it willingly. No matter what role the devil may have played in Jesus going to the cross, he couldn't stop the plan. See, God knows the mind of Satan. And he knew exactly what the devil would do. And he worked it into his plan. Did you see this? That your problem, that you're suffering, whatever you're dealing with, whatever trial or tribulation, whatever mountain it is, sometimes God's saying, trust me. And I know very well that if I don't learn that lesson, I'm going to have to repeat the test again. You know, in school, you don't pass the test, and if you fail enough of them, you have to repeat the grade or the class. Well, let me tell you something. In my walk with Christ, in your walk with Christ, sometimes we fail a lot of tests and we have to repeat them. Think about it. And you wonder, why? God, why did you say, God's just trying to tell us sometimes, learn the lesson. Because when you learn the lesson, in other words, you know the truth, then you're made free. He cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Some of those thought he was calling out for Elijah. Some said, now, maybe you've said this before, just let them suffer, they'll get through it. Now, sometimes I believe we need to teach, especially sometimes our children, we need to teach them hard lessons. If we're always bailing people out of a situation, they never learn how to get themselves out of it. Hello? So sometimes we need to learn that lesson. Some of these people were just cruel. Let him deal with it. Let's see if Elijah really does come and save him. Because see, they didn't understand the plan of salvation after he had been talking and walking with them for over 3 years. They didn't understand that this had to happen in order for you to be saved, in order for you to be free. It had to happen. They didn't get that. Jesus cried out again in verse 50 and yielded up his spirit. Then, behold, I like that word. Behold. In verse 51, the veil of the temple was torn into from top to bottom. The earth quaked and the rocks were split. And the graves were opened. Oh, friends, we think of Jesus being resurrected on the third day after he was buried. But hello, I'm telling you, according to Scripture, that when Jesus cried out, John especially says, it is finished. When Jesus said, it is finished, the Bible says that the veil in the temple was torn in two. That's the veil that separated man from God. That separated people from getting into the mercy seat to obtain mercy on their lives.
Amen.
Oh, glory to Jesus. That veil that separated you and I from the presence of God, God says, it's no longer needed. And he tore it. I can just imagine God's hands coming down and just putting it on and just ripping it. You ever see those people rip phone books in half? Well, this is a lot more than that. I once talked to, well, actually, it was a thing with, he was called the world's strongest redneck. He was pretty strong. He would tear phone books, and he would tear all this stuff. But let me tell you something. No man could have torn this veil in two. No matter what, and no man in their flesh could have done it. But it was when Jesus declared, the plan of salvation is finished. God took that veil, tore it in two. The Bible says that there was an earthquake, stones were moved. See, this wasn't just any other day. This wasn't just any other crucifixion. This marked the point where I could say, I'm saved and I know I am.
Amen.
Amen.
This was the point where the blood of Jesus that had been shed on that cross eternally bought your, my salvation. Oh, friend, that should excite you. I'm saved because of what Jesus has done. I'm saved because of what happened on the cross. Oh, glory. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not all of his benefits, because he didn't just stop there. According to the scripture, not only was the nail torn into, not only did the earthquake and the rocks moved, but bodies that were in the grave, like this, arose. See, before Jesus arose on the third day, these bodies that were in the grave came up.
Amen.
From the grave. We like singing that, but let me tell you, friends, before he came out of the grave, these bodies began to surface. Why? Because the price had been paid for their salvation. These were people who had followed the law, who had walked, who had been in paradise. And their bodies came up. Glory to Jesus. He says, and coming out of the graves in verse 53, after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Many. See, the only thing holding them down at that point was this flesh. What's holding you back right now, what's holding you back today, is really your flesh. Because you, if you're a believer, if you've received the grace of God upon your life, let me tell you, friends, your spirit's right with God. If you were truly saved, your spirit is right with God. It's just sometimes the flesh doesn't get it. I like to say, I know that I'm healed, my flesh just hasn't caught up with the word yet. Sometimes that's the case. The word doesn't change, but my flesh does. I'm not going to keep you too long. I know you got Easter dinner. I promise I'll be up before 3. Some of you came this morning. Bound, well, all of us in some way. We're all addicted to something. We all are. Frankly, I'm addicted to air. Hello, I need air. But we all have something that in our flesh that holds us back. I'm a prankster. One time I was in a class, a seminar, and the teacher was talking about this, and he said, I'm addicted to chocolate chip cookies. Me, I'm just a prankster, and during the break, I went out and got him some chocolate chip cookies and put on the podium. I wouldn't recommend it. But we're all addicted to something. We all have something that's holding us back. Maybe it's fear. Maybe it's fear of the unknown. Well, hello, none of us know the unknown. I don't know what heaven's like, but I know that I'm going there and it's going to be beautiful.
Amen.
Some people, I know, I appreciate the ministry of Sherry and Hospice. Some of those people go into that time in their life afraid of what's going to happen next. Do they not? They're afraid of not just necessarily whether they're going to heaven or hell, but sometimes they're just afraid because they don't know what's coming next. Frankly, I'd be more concerned, and this is just me, I'd be more concerned with my eternal placement than with anything else. Am I going to heaven or am I not? But you see, when Jesus entered the depths, Ephesians says that he went and he took the keys away. Bible says he took the keys of death, hell, and the grave. So you see, I'm not worried about if I walk out of here, if I die. Really, if I do, it's because God said it was time. Hope you know that. Don't be like the Christian Scientist who stood out in front of a tractor trailer and after tractor trailer hit him. He said, my arm's not dislocated, my head's not bleeding. Here's what I'm saying is, we don't have to worry about those things. What matters is not what you're saying, it's what he says over your life. I'm not worried if I walk out of here and something and my life changes. Do I want it to? Would I be happy? No! I want to see your smiling faces for at least another few years. There we go. Get some smiles. But if it happens, you know what? It's okay. Because when Jesus took the keys of the grave, I have nothing more to fear. I don't fear death. I don't fear hell. Because I ain't going there. So many people now are talking about the end times and fearing walking, Christians now fearing of walking through the tribulation. Can I tell you, friends, I don't fear it. I don't fear whatever hell comes upon this earth. I don't believe it's the actual hell that's coming, but some people call it hell. I'm not afraid of any hell that could come here on earth. Mainly because I believe that the scripture says that God has not appointed us to wrath. That's what the tribulation is for. It's wrath for those who have not received. Now, there'll be some saved for them, but that's not the purpose of it. I don't fear what tomorrow brings. Sometimes I get a little apprehensive. I worry. So do you. Don't tell me you don't. Don't lie to the preacher. Sometimes we get apprehensive. We begin to worry about situations. Your finances or your health or your family. But I believe there's a freedom we can walk in. If you're praying for your family, let me just tell you, according to Scripture, that you can be saved and your household.
Amen.
If you'll just pray and believe it. Speak it. Share the word of life over their life. And if you can't do it, let me just tell you, pray that God will put someone else in their path. I've seen it happen. Because sometimes you can't reach your relatives, but someone else can. Maybe you've come in here and you've got guilt on you for whatever you think you've done. Can I tell you God loves you? Can I tell you you don't have to walk out of here with that guilt on your life? Because the blood of Jesus Christ washes whiter than snow. You don't have to walk out thinking, look what I did yesterday or the day before or when. I'm telling you there's forgiveness and freedom through the blood of Jesus Christ. You see, not just because of his death sealed my salvation, but his resurrection sealed my victory. His resurrection sealed my freedom. Sometimes miserable people go to heaven. Hello. Jerry and I were talking about getting into the nosebleed section in heaven. Yeah, I'm just glad I'm there. But you know what? Sometimes miserable people, people that have been saved by the blood of Jesus, but they are miserable people. Well, the resurrection of Jesus Christ secured that I don't have to be miserable anymore. I don't have to be bound down to those things. I don't have to be so encaged in a tomb in those things. But the stone has been rolled away, and you're now free.
Amen.
It's like the old story about the dog who always was on a chain and knew his perimeter. One day his owner took the chain off and he still stayed in that perimeter because he didn't know he was free. So he stayed in that perimeter. Friends, I want to tell you something. The blood of Jesus Christ got you in, but it's his resurrection that freed you from the chain. It's his resurrection that said you don't have to stay in the tomb until the day of resurrection. And I believe in the day of resurrection, friends. I believe there's a day coming, according to 1 Thessalonians, where the dead in Christ will rise first. Well, first of all, the trumpet of God will sound. The dead in Christ will rise. and that those who are alive and remain will be caught up in the air to meet him. And forever, everybody say forever.
Forever.
Forever will be with the Lord. Heaven is not just a temporary lodging place. But we don't have to be stuck in that tomb while we're here. Always worried about what if, now hear this, what if someone in church finds out I'm not perfect? Seriously, there's churches where they'll just, I don't have anything to do with you because you're not perfect. Now I believe there are standards, okay? And I believe that we should walk. But hear this, friends, there's forgiveness, there's hope. There's mercy that goes beyond those chains that you've been wearing. You see, maybe you've walked in and came here today and you're just so bound. Let me tell you, fear is paralyzing. It will paralyze you. But freedom, he who the Son sets free, is free indeed. I like that. Indeed. He who the Son sets free is not bound, is not set up, is not just always like this. But you've been free. I'm free to worship because I have no more guilt in my life. Look at that. I'm free to praise God. I don't have to worry about the devil saying, what do you have to praise him for? I know what you're like. You don't have to worry about that. I don't have to worry about that. You don't have to be bound by what the world says. You have been made free in Christ. I want to read something for you. It's a song. But it so sums up. I'm going to dismiss maybe in half hour. I want you to read this. And Michele, would you come up and play that last song? We're just going to play it for right now. I want you to hear the words to this song. It's called There Is a Blood. And while we're doing that, I just want to say to you, as I'm reading these words, I want to tell you something. This altar is open for you. If you need freedom today, I want you to come up. We're going to pray for you. We're going to declare freedom over your life. Listen to this. He said, there is a blood that cost a life, that paid my way, death its price. When it flowed down from the cross, my sins were gone, my sins forgot. There is a grave that tried to hide this precious blood that gave me life. In 3 days, he breathed again and rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you. This life, this price, this blood, this one. There's a blood and it sights the blind. It heals the sick, the lonely finds. Oh, it has power to free the bound as chains they fall upon the ground. So pour it out and cleanse my soul and let its liquid glory flow. Because it lives to make me whole, I owe my life, I owe my all. So I've come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. So I've come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you. If anyone needs prayer this morning, I want you to come up. What for whatever it is, don't be bound by fear. Don't be bound by those things. Get loose of what you're dealing with and receive the victory and the freedom. Take communion. I want know this specifically, the only requirement upon your life, the only requirement upon you taking communion is that you not just have said words, but you acknowledge by faith that it is by grace that you're saved, not of works. That you have decided and walk in the fact that you put your trust for your salvation wholly and completely in the blood of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that on the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave thanks and said, "This do in remembrance of me." So today it's an honor on Resurrection Sunday to honor the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm glad we're not stuck there, but we can honor and remember what he did for us on the cross. So Father, I thank you for the body of Christ which was broken for us. I thank you that every beating he took, the crown on his head, the thorns, the nails through his hands and feet, every whipping, every brutal punishment that he took was so we could claim the rights of children. So, Father, we receive this today in the name of our precious Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Take your bread. The same manner he took the cup. He blessed it. He said, "Drink, because this is the blood of my New Testament, my new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me." Paul also said that as we take this, we remember his death and proclaim his soon return. So I want you to remember, friend, that there is life in the blood. Father, we thank you for this cup. It symbolizes the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for us. Today we receive it by faith, knowing that there is life in the blood, and without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sins. So we receive it today in faith, thankful for what was done for us, but also looking forward to the return of Jesus Christ to take us home. We're looking for that city whose builder and maker is God. So we receive this by faith, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.
You were the Word in the beginning, one with God, the Lord of Christ. You're in glory in creation. What a powerful name it is.